Hello and welcome to Totally Doctor Who.
We've got a cracker of a programme lined up for you, but first, did you see that last episode of Doctor Who? It was awesome. I think it was my favourite one.
I have to agree there, but I'm not too sure about the Weeping Angels. They're a bit scary, aren't they?
Yeah, like what was it they were saying again? Do not look away, don't turn your back, and do not blink.
Very important that you don't blink, OK? I'm watching you. I have my eyes on you. Do not blink. Did that just move? That was further back.
It's probably just our imagination, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I suppose it is. Yeah, yeah. OK, let's carry on. So where was I? Well, I was totally freaked out about the Weeping Angel moving. That is definitely moving closer.
No, you're right, that is definitely moving. Hang on, I've got a plan, because they are really fast. Maybe you could help us stop them touching us, sending us back in the past. Why don't you maintain eye contact for us? OK, keep looking.
Yeah, do not look away. Remember that. Don't look away, do not turn your back. And whatever you do, do not blink.
Thanks for your help. So where were we? Oh, yeah, we were talking about how amazing that last episode of Doctor Who...
Oh, hang on, I can see eyelids twitching.
Oh, no,
stop
twitching.
No, don't blink. Don't blink.
Come on,
don't.
Open them. Pick them up.
No!
Oh, no. It's right behind us, isn't it?
Yeah. Roll the titles. I just hope we're here when you come back.
We got away from that Weeping Angel. Oh, or maybe not. Actually, it doesn't matter, because we're looking at Doctor Who baddies on Totally today. We're going to do a top 10 countdown of all the meanest, baddest baddies that you love to hate. Where will your favourite come? Also, more chances to win prizes in Who Goes There? More from Team Totally, more from our exclusive animation, The Infinite Quest. We catch up with John Barrowman, a.k.a. Captain Jack, on location. And right now, find out what it's like to be a Doctor Who monster with Paul Kasey, the man behind the masks.
Yeah, we're going to meet Paul very shortly, but first, let's say hello to our TGR studio guests. Say hiya.
Hi!
Now, today we're talking about our top 10 bad guys. Who's your worst bad guy?
Cybermen!
Oh, I heard about four then. Daleks, Cybermen, Oods... Slovenes, very good. Well, we're going to find out the official bad guy a bit later. But first, it's time to meet Paul Kasey, the man behind the masks of Doctor Who. How are you doing, Paul? All right?
Hi, Barney. Yeah, I'm good, thanks.
Now, we saw you on the last series of Totally. You came in as a Cyberman. But since then, we've had another series and plenty more costumes, I'm guessing. So tell us about the bad guys that you've played today.
I've played Auton, Slovene, Tree from Cheam, and Zuzanna, the android.
Yeah.
Clockwork droid. An Ood.
An Ood.
A Santa robot. And then on this series, Jadoon Captain and a Pigman.
When you're playing Jadoon and Cyberman, they're quite similar, aren't they? They're quite close together. So do you have to think about the movement that you use there?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the concentration all the time on set, you know, just to make sure that how we've been rehearsed is what we do on set.
Now, we have a question for you from Asha.
What was your favourite monster and why?
If I had to choose a favourite, I think it would have to be a Cyberman, definitely.
Because?
I think just the costume and the look of them and the fact I got to delete a lot of people.
That always works, doesn't it? All right, then, JB, have you got a question?
How long does it take you to get into your costume?
They all vary. Average about sort of half an hour to three quarters of an hour. The more we film, though, the quicker the process does get. The longest, though, so far, I think, for me, was the Trees from Cheam, which was 3 to 3.5 hours to get into the prosthetics.
That is a long time. And prosthetics, of course, are when you build up various elements of rubber on the face, and you do it so often, don't you? And then eventually you have a finished mask. 3.5 hours, that's a long time.
Yeah.
What happens if you need to go and do the loo?
Well, we get loo breaks.
Oh, OK, that's good.
Yes, they're very kind.
Well, listen, we're about to find out all about prosthetics now because Team TARDIS and Team Time Lord have got a prosthetics challenge. Who do you think's going to win?
Welcome to Team Totally. Competing are Team Time Lord. They are... Cody, her favourite monster is the Empty Child. Alia, his favourite monsters are the Cybermen. And Sara, her favourite monsters are the Clockwork Droids. Up against Team Time Lord are Team TARDIS. They are... Chris, his favourite monster is the Beast. Molly, her favourite monster is the Werewolf. And Daniel, his favourite monsters are the Daleks. For 12 weeks, our teams will have the opportunity to take 2 points for winning a task and 1 point for being runners-up. The team with the most points will win a money-can't-buy Doctor Who experience. Who will win? Only time will tell. In the penultimate task before the studio final, the scores are 13-14. Which of our teams will make the most of 2 points in the roles of special effects technicians?
A job role is basically sculpting, designing, moulding, casting, animatronics, facial prosthesis.
And having brought to life the Jadoon, the Carrionites and the Scarecrows, Charlie and Lauren are the perfect people to set and judge today's task.
The mission, if you choose to accept it, to sculpt gargoyles. The gargoyle is a creature or a monster that you usually put on the outside the side of a religious building, basically to warn away demons. Go as mad as you want to and create something as hideous and monstrous as you like. OK, teams, you've got to follow me over here.
Charlie firstly demonstrates how to sculpt a gargoyle face that will later become a mould for a latex monster head. Working on a cast of an actor's face, small pieces of wet clay are used to build up the sculpture piece by piece.
You actually find a lot of the creatures that we might make for Doctor Who, we take a lot of reference from the animal world.
Charlie also demonstrates how to use a selection of tools to add finer details to their creations.
OK, teams, now showing you the basics of it, it's your turn to basically show me up and show me what good artist you are.
Okay, I've had a really good idea.
The teams discuss how their gargoyles should look.
I want to do a pig's nose. The eyes are there.
Yeah.
The mouth is still there, but he's got the teeth coming up there.
Right.
Both teams add clay to their casts. Team Time Lord quickly mark out features on their monster head.
I think it looks better that way or that way.
Right.
Team TARDIS are also marking out features, but can't decide where on the head they should be.
I'm just literally marking out.
What is that?
That's not a mouth, is it?
So that's his top lip.
No.
You do it.
30 minutes have passed, and both teams have built up their gargoyles, adding noses, eyes, and teeth. But is Team Time Lord's hard work about to be undone by someone being over-eager with the water spray?
I think he's spraying a bit too much.
I spray way too much.
Yeah, I know.
Don't spray anymore because look where it's all the pattern's gone.
No, I'll spray.
As Alia continues to spray water, Chris is questioning Team TARDIS's efforts.
This looks terribly messy.
Shush.
Molly.
You've got to listen to Chris, by the way.
Yeah,
I know, but I don't agree that.
You don't agree, see?
I like it.
With a few minutes of sculpting left, Sarah is adding the finishing touches to the gargoyle, and Alia is only too keen to help.
Get some scales around the eye.
No!
Oh, God, I couldn't see
it. No! I have to leave my eye alone.
Alia, leave it. I'll just use my finger to smooth over the skin over now.
Gargoyle complete. Team TARDIS have decided to name their creature after someone very familiar to Daniel.
Steve.
Yeah. Named after my dad. He looks like him.
Oh, lovely.
Having completed the clay sculpting, the teams make a plaster cast mould of their gargoyle. Once dry, Charlie and Lauren add liquid latex to the mould, followed by foam. As the foam dries, what are our team's thoughts on their efforts?
I think we're going to win because we've got nice texture and good place of the fangs and the eyes.
I think I'm happy with everything on the gargoyle because we all made it together and made sure that everybody agreed.
Both teams think they stand a chance of winning, but who will be unmasked as the winner? Stay tuned to find out later.
Close. Find out if it's Team TARDIS or Time Lord that take the 2 points a little bit later on in the programme.
Hiya.
What have you come at?
Today, right, listen, we're doing the top 10 countdown of the worst Doctor Who baddies ever. So I thought we could do it like they do on the telly. I've got your costume all sorted.
What are we, bad DJs?
Yes, really
bad
DJs.
Cue the music.
Rocketing in at number 10, we have the evil and the ruthless Balthazar. After doing time on the prison planet Bolognok, Balthazar becomes obsessed by the Infinite. It's a starship that will give him his heart's desire. This sneaky schemer is relentless in his pursuit, and we've certainly seen that he won't let anyone or anything get in his way. Not off.
Down one at nine, it's Werewolf. Originating from a crash landing on Earth, this big hairy fright has developed through cellular matter passed down through the generations. Manifesting as a local lad by day, you wouldn't want to cross this enormous beast on a full moon. Bullets won't stop it, but oil of mistletoe might slow it down. But if you want to destroy it for good, you'll need a duel in a telescope. But just don't get bitten first. Ow! A world's next boss.
And at number 8, we have the Carrier Knights. These cackling witchy creatures may have the ability to appear young and beautiful, but inside, they are ancient, unadulterated evil. They have a vicious way with words. Their poetry is often deadly. They are definitely a worthy new addition to the top 10. Ah, scary.
Another new entry at 7. It's Lazarus, a terrifying creature that dangerously mutates from the professor's unstable DNA. This monster is human in origin, but forms from some dormant genes reactivated by the Lazarus machine. He drains his victims of their life energy, leaving them as dry husks, whilst he gets ever stronger. Over to you, Barn.
In at number 6, these slimy bat-like shape changers are known as the Krillitanes. They were last seen masquerading as teachers in Defree High School. They are an alien race who pick and choose physical traits they find useful from the species they conquer, incorporating them into their own bodies. They are eaters of children and rats, and enemy to the doctor and all humankind.
And what? There we will leave it for now. Find out who's at that all-important number 1 spot a little bit later on in the programme.
Not off.
But now, at 10, we had Balthazar. Have you ever wondered how that bad boy gets created?
As it happens, I have. I like bad boys being created.
Oh, well, you can find out exactly how now. Let's get changed.
Yeah, go. Yeah.
I'm Steve. And I'm John. And we're Firestep, and we're animating The Infinite Quest. Designing buddies is the most fun you can have in my job. And the main buddy in this show is Balthazar.
I'm the king of the world. King of the world! King of the world!
Quiet, Cor. This is my moment of destiny.
The character of Balthazar wasn't always the same. In earlier versions of the script, he was a time traveler and he was a woman. And the same goes for his ship, which was more like a pirate ship originally before we settled on the final version of his ship that looks like Cor. We came up with the design for Balthazar, working together with the scriptwriters. The final idea for him and his character was that he was a kind of space pirate. Balthazar's got glowing blue eyes and green glowing breathing apparatus, and they help for when he's in the dark or he's out of shot, you can hear him and you can see him. The look of the shirt is kind of a sailor's shirt, and the mechanical arm is kind of a space age version of Captain Hook's hook.
Is that not just the most incredible plan you've ever heard?
And the plan starts in seconds.
Balthazar is voiced by a great actor called Anthony Head. And when he first did the voice, it was like nothing we'd ever imagined. And when we put it with the drawings, it was fantastic.
Attention, Armory.
Prepare plasma cannons for firing. Commence countdown.
The next stage is actually making the animation, and that's where the characters get to act. And to help us do this, we build a library of character parts. So for Balthazar, we had a torso, lots of arms in different positions, and unusually for him, we built his head in 3D because he had so many mechanical parts, so we could get a full head rotation. Once we've got the completed Balthazar, then we bring it into the scene over the rough drawings that we've done on the animated storyboard. And it's at this stage that it gets really exciting because we get to animate the character and Balthazar gets to act.
And now I'm going to envelop Earth in a field of plasma fire.
So now you know how we make our villain Balthazar, all those different elements coming together. But the best thing about working on the animation is we get to find out what happens to him in the end. Should we tell him, Steve?
Nah. Have to keep on watching.
We got the next part of our exclusive animation on the way. I'm totally Doctor Who. Don't move.
Now though, it's not move. Now though, it's time for me to say something.
What is it?
Who goes there and there and there and there?
To get hold of an exclusive sweatshirt as modelled by Paul Kasey and the gang up there. Thank you very much. All you need to do is work out what is going on behind there. You okay. Always go in there. I'm going to go in, actually.
All right.
Give it a bit
and
of a
And reveal
go.
The silhouette, please.
Hoo-ha!
Is that how you greet people now? I like it.
Well,
hoo-ha.
He was attacking me.
Yeah, he looks vicious. Can you give us a clue as to what that might be?
No, I simply want to dance.
OK, whilst Kirsten walks like an Egyptian, maybe you can cast your eye over that silhouette and work out which Doctor Who baddie that may be. You can write to us at Totally Doctor Who, PO Box 5158, Cardiff, CF59BD. or you can email us, totallydoctorwho@bbc.co.uk. That's the email address. Get in touch.
By the way, if your name is on the screen right now, congratulations, you've already worked out what one of our monsters is, and you've got yourself one of these sweatshirts.
Nice.
Like my style there?
I'll hold it and model it.
I did promise you it was time for our animation. Now, the final data chip held by Gurney is on Volagnot, which is the prison planet, but Gurney and Martha are trapped in Gurney's office, and something is about to smash its way in. What can it be?
I don't know.
We'll find out. Balthazar's back. He started this quest in the first place. And he's got his metal bird with him. Totally exclusive for you now. Remember when Cor gave Martha that little bird-shaped brooch? Keep your eye out for that. Now then, we've got Paul Kasey here, Monster Man. Actually, do you think Balthazar is as scary as some of the monsters you've played?
Almost.
But not quite.
Not quite.
You're probably right, actually. Would you do us the honours of adding your handprint to our wall of fame, please? You've got to press quite hard. Remember, you can win all of these. All you need to do is answer 12 questions. You've had 9 already. If you've missed any, head to the website pronto, because you're about to furnish us with the next question, but not before I've set the mood. So can I have some mood lighting, please? And some tension music. Thank you very much. Take it away, Paul.
The 10th question is, what does the guard ask the Doctor and Martha when they arrive at Silo 16?
Indeed, that's your question. You need to watch the next episode of Doctor Who for the answer. Good luck with that.
Sam's going off!
What's going on?
I've got a very, very cool thing for you now. It's an exclusive, by the way, and it involves Captain Jack.
What is it?
Have a look in there.
Oh.
All will be revealed. You don't get much more exclusive than this. Look who's back. It's Captain Jack.
Hey.
Being looked after by the ladies as usual.
Yeah, absolutely. That's right. Well, I'm covered in mud. Where we're filming today is a quarry that looks actually like it's got poo all over the ground.
Nice.
Like a baby's nappy.
But, you know, all made better by the fact that you're back with a doctor. How does that feel?
It feels fantastic. It's, you know, Jack's back on the TARDIS. You know, with a new assistant, and he's come back. The great thing about Jack is he's come back to the TARDIS. He's a hero now.
Yeah.
And, you know, because when he was left on Satellite 5, he had to survive until he was desperate to find the Doctor, and now he's found him again, and here he is. And he's coming back to prove himself, kind of, to the Doctor. And also, the Doctor's going to, he's going to learn stuff from the Doctor, and the audience is also going to learn a lot about Jack.
And of course, last time we saw you got quite close to Rose. I mean, does Martha get the thumbs up as well? Do you like her?
Gets the thumbs up.
Oh, good. That's a good sign.
She's a hottie.
We know this. Now, yeah. Listen, you're going to be around for the next couple of episodes as well.
Yes.
I've seen you here at the end of the universe.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, there are certain rules and regulations where you can't tell us too much about
yourself. That's right.
Can you tell us anything about the next couple of episodes?
I cannot tell you a thing.
Can you draw it? So that happens. Okay, with one of those.
Yeah, and wow. This, and then one becomes like this.
Oh, wow.
Right?
Yes.
And I get all that.
You get one of those?
Yeah, I get one of those, and then I go back into this.
Yes.
And then that's that, and then I do this. Yeah, from there, and I go that way, and then that way, and that's revealed.
And that comes
and
back around full circle.
Comes like
else.
That,
that,
and then
amazing.
Everything does that, and it looks kind of like.
You have to show it. You have to show
that.
It.
Oh, brilliant! Captain Jack is back. I'm not sure that's ever going to make sense to me, though.
I've worked it out. The people with the round face eat the people with the square face, and then these two do a dance.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. It's not very scary, though, is it?
Whilst we continue to try and decipher this, it's time for you to tuck into Team Totally Part 2.
Our two teams have been competing as special effects technicians and have been sculpting gargoyle heads like those seen in episode 10. Both teams have let their imaginations run wild, though not without some bickering.
Shush. Molly, you gotta listen to Chris, by the way. You can see what he's doing. I have to use my eye alone.
As they wait for the final foam versions of their monsters, how confident are the teams about winning?
I'm pretty confident that we're going to win, and I hope my other teammates are.
Now we finished our sculpture, I'm really confident that we're going to win because it looks really good.
OK, welcome back, teams. This is the big unveiling. So we're going to start with Team TARDIS. Lauren, if you do the honours. Very nice.
Whoa. We're going to win.
Team Time Lord. Here we go. Excellent, very nice. OK, down to the judging. First, the best originality. I've gone with Team TARDIS. Really good job, very nice. Then on to the next bit, best texture. big, very important thing in sculpting, really sells the realistic product. And for that, I've gone with Team Time Lords. So it's a draw. Me and Lauren, we've sat down, we've spoken about it, but we've had to go with the ultimate part, which is originality. So, Team TARDIS, you've won. Congratulations to both teams. Really, really good job.
I feel quite happy that we've won because it will actually help us on our points. So I think we may win the overall thing.
I was a bit disappointed that we didn't win today, but that we won on texture. I was really pleased with that because I think that ours was really textured and that was our main thing.
With the runners-up remaining upbeat, the scores are now 15 points each. Who will win the last vital 2 points before the big final? Make sure you watch next time to find out. Congratulations to Team TARDIS making it all square. Tune in next time to see who manages to get their noses in front.
Now, though, it's time to carry on with our top 10 countdown of the worst Doctor Who baddies. We're now picking up with 5-1. Cue the music.
Down 2 at 5, Clockwork Droids. These obsessive, brain-hungry repair androids will stop at nothing to mend their damaged spaceship, the SS Madame de Pompadour. With a penchant for hiding under beds, these villains don't snooze on the job. Driven by clockwork, they never break down in a power cut and have sturdy blades that extend from their arms.
Paul, you were a clockwork droid. Are you happy with that position?
Yeah, number 5 is a good number.
Good number? What's at 4, Barn?
At number 4, it's the Slitheen. They are a massive 8 feet tall and made of calcium. They have the technology to compress their huge bulk to wedge into human bodies for disguise. They are a family who have escaped from the planet Raxacargafalapatorius, as they are wanted for many crimes. Of course, Paul, you know all about the Slitheen too, having played them. Would you say number 4 is a good position for them?
Yeah, a good position, and I certainly wouldn't want to meet one on a dark night.
He knows what he's talking about. Kirst, who's at number 3?
It's the Sycorax. They are so hideous looking that they keep their features hidden under a helmet of bone. They speak Sycoraxic and they have a lifespan of over 400 years. They fight using swords and whips, and the Doctor managed to beat the leader in a sword fight and save the world again, although he did lose a hand in the process. So what's at number 2?
At number 2, Kirst, we have the Cyberman. Deadly and terrifying robots from a parallel Earth. Now, these chunks of metal, whose only ambition is to survive, used to be human. But all the flesh and blood was removed and replaced with steel, motors and electronics, so they no longer have feelings, making them ready and armed to delete, delete, delete. Paul, what do you think? The Cybermen at number 2?
Personally, Barney, I would have put them at 1. They petrified me as a child.
I'm with you on that one. Definitely my most feared baddie. But actually, there is an even more terrifying Doctor's adversary, and he's at number 1. Kirst, tell us.
The Daleks, the most feared and hated creatures in the whole universe. Originally from the planet Skaro, their only ambition is to conquer and exterminate all living things. Powered by static electricity and covered by armoured casing, they're a fearsome enemy for all who cross their paths. Their epic battles against the Time Lords have been played out across time and space. And with casualty counts high on both sides, who knows if this duel will ever be resolved? I bet we've not seen the last of them yet.
So there you have it. That is the totally top 10 countdown of our worst bad guys. What do you reckon? Daleks at number 1, do we agree with that?
Yeah!
Oh, Paul's not too sure we know about the Cybermen. Well, stay tuned, because that, of course, can all change. Over the next few weeks, there may be a new baddie in town.
Ooh.
Oh, hello.
Oh, yes. Studio's gone crackers. That can mean only one thing.
Dalek Khan, you're going to love this. It's time now for a sneak peek of the next episode of Doctor Who.
Is it me, or does that look like a hunt? Come on!
I've got you!
He's coming!
They're coming!
What the hell are they?
There's more of them. We've got to keep going.
I've got a ship nearby. It's safe. It's not far. It's over there.
We're moving on.
How great does that look? The first episode in a 3-parter, which of course stars Captain Jack. He's back, and I have to say, you're in for a bit of a shock this week.
Make sure you do not miss that. Paul, thanks very much for being here.
Thank you.
And
thanks,
to all our guests. Thanks, guys, for coming in.
Thank
we will
you.
See you very soon. Bye.
See ya.
Bye. Bye.